a coconut tree. Chicka chicka boom boom, will there be enough bread? Here comes H up the coconut tree, and I and J and tag along K, all on their way up the coconut tree. Chicka chicka boom boom, will there be enough room? Look who's coming, L, M, N, O, P, and Q, R, S, and T, U, V. Still more W and X, Y, Z. The whole alphabet up the... Oh, no!
Chicka, chicka.
Boom! Boom! Skit, skat, scoodle, doot. Everybody running to the coconut tree. Mamas and papas and uncles and aunts hug their little dears, then dust their pants.
Except getting a bath. So one day, when he heard the water running in the tub, he took the scrubbing brush and buried it in the backyard. Then he ran away from home. He played where they were fixing the street. He played at the railroad.
Mm-hmm.
and got even dirtier. He played tag with other dogs. And became dirtier still. He slid down a coal chute and got the dirtiest of all. In fact, he changed from a white dog with black spots to a black dog with white spots. Although there were many other things to do, Harry began to wonder if his family thought that he had really run away. He felt tired and hungry, too. So, without stopping on the way, he ran back home. When Harry got to his house, he crawled through the fence and sat looking at the back door. One of the family looked out and said, "There's a strange dog in the backyard. By the way, has anyone seen Harry?" When Harry heard this, he tried very hard to show them he was Harry. He started to do all his old clever tricks. He flip-flopped. And he flop-flipped. He rolled over and played dead. He danced. And he sang. He did these tricks over and over again, but everyone shook his head and said, "Oh no, it couldn't be Harry." Harry gave up and walked slowly toward the gate. But suddenly, he stopped. He ran to a corner of the garden and started to dig furiously. Soon, he jumped away from the hole, barking short, happy barks. He'd found the scrubbing brush. And carrying it in his mouth, he ran into the house. Up the stairs he dashed, with the family following close behind. He jumped into the bathtub and sat up begging, with the scrubbing brush in his mouth, a trick he certainly had never done before. "This little doggy wants a bath," cried the little girl. And her father said, "Why don't you and your brother give him one?" Harry's bath was the soapiest one he'd ever had. It worked like magic. As soon as the children started to scrub, they began shouting, "Mommy, Daddy, look, look, come quick!" It's Harry! It's Harry! It's Harry! They cried. Harry wagged his tail and was very, very happy. His family combed and brushed him lovingly, and he became, once again, a white dog with black spots. It was wonderful to be home. After dinner, Harry fell asleep in his favorite place, happily dreaming of how much fun it had been getting dirty. He slept so soundly, he didn't even feel the scrubbing brush he'd hidden under his pillow.
The wheels on the bus go round and round, round and round, round and round. The wheels on the bus go round and round, all over town. La-ta-ta-ta, la-ta-ta, la-ta-ta, la-ta-ta-ta. The wheels go round and round. The doors on the bus go open and shut, open and shut, open and shut. The doors on the bus go open and shut all over town. The people on the bus step out and in, out and in, out and in. The people on the bus step out and in all over town. The driver on the bus says, move on back, move on back, move on back. Driver on the bus says, move on back, all over town. La-da-ta-ta-ta. La-da-ta-ta-ta. Slide up and down, up and down, up and down. The windows on the bus slide up and down, all over town. The wipers on the bus go swish, 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 swish. The wipers on the bus go swish, 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 all over town. La-da-ta-ta-ta. La-da-ta-ta-ta, la-da-ta-ta-ta, all over town. The riders on the bus go bumpity-bump, bumpity-bump, bumpity-bump. The riders on the bus go bumpity-bump. All over town. The babies on the bus cry, wah, 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 wah. The babies on the bus cry, wah, 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 all over town. The mothers on the bus go, shh, 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 shh. The mothers on the bus go, shh, 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 all over town. Town.
One day, Chicken Little was playing in the yard when, whack, an acorn hit her on the head.
The sky is falling. The sky is falling,
she said.
I have to tell Cocky Locky. Cocky Locky, Cocky Locky, the sky is falling. The sky is falling,
Cocky Locky said.
It is? Well then, we have to tell Ducky Daddles.
Ducky Daddles, Ducky Daddles, the sky is falling. The sky is falling,
Ducky Daddles said.
It is? Well then, we have to tell Goosey Poosey.
Goosey Poosey, Goosey Poosey, the sky is falling. The sky is falling,
Goosey Poosey said.
It is? Well then, we have to tell Turkey Lurkey.
Turkey Lurkey, Turkey Lurkey, the sky is falling. The sky is falling,
Turkey Lurkey said.
It is? Well then, we have to tell the king.
But on the way to tell the king, they met Foxy Woxy.
Foxy Woxy, Foxy Woxy, the sky is falling. The sky is falling. We have to tell the king,
Foxy Woxy said.
I can help. Follow me. I know a shortcut to the king.
Foxy Woxy led Chicken Little, Cocky Locky, Ducky Daddles, Goosey Poosey, and Turkey Lurkey right to his den. He licked his lips and said,
"Step inside to see the king."
"Tricky Foxy Woxy, the king is not in there,"
they shouted and ran away as fast as they could. At last, they arrived at the castle.
"King! King! The sky is falling! The sky is falling! A piece of it fell on my head!"
"The sky is not falling. An acorn fell on your head,"
the king chuckled as he plucked the acorn from Chicken Little's head. And so, Turkey Lurkey, Goosey Poosey, Ducky Daddles, Cocky Locky, and Chicken Little went back home.
Phew! The sky is not falling.
The Snowy Day by Ezra Jack Keats. One winter morning, Peter woke up and looked out the window. Snow had fallen during the night. It covered everything as far as he could see. After breakfast, he put on his snowsuit and ran outside. The snow was piled up very high along the street to make a path for walking. Crunch, crunch, crunch. His feet sank into the snow. He walked with his toes pointing out, like this. He walked with his toes pointing in, like that. Then he dragged his feet slowly to make tracks. And he found something sticking out of the snow that made a new track. It was a stick. A stick that was just right for smacking a snow-covered tree. Down fell the snow, plop, on top of Peter's head. Thank you. He thought it would be fun to join the big boys in their snowball fight. But he knew he wasn't old enough. Not yet. So he made a smiling snowman. And he made angels. He pretended he was a mountain climber. He climbed up a great, big, tall, heaping mountain of snow and slid all the way down. He picked up a handful of snow and another and still another. He packed it round and firm and put the snowball in his pocket for tomorrow. Then he went into his warm house. He told his mother all about his adventures while she took off his wet socks. And he thought and thought and thought about them. Before he got into bed, he looked in his pocket. His pocket was empty. The snowball wasn't there. He felt very sad. While he slept, he dreamed that the sun had melted all the snow away. His dream was gone. The snow was still everywhere. New snow was falling. After breakfast, he called to his friend from across the hall, and they went out together into the deep, deep snow.
Hey, down on the farm, Duck got a wild idea.
I bet I could ride a bike, he thought.
He waddled over to where the boy parked his bike, climbed on, and began to ride. At first, he rode very slowly, and he wobbled a lot. But it was fun. Duck rode past Cow and waved to her.
Hello, Cow, said Duck.
Meow, said Cow.
But what she thought was,
a duck on a bike? That's the silliest thing I've ever seen.
Then Duck rode past Sheep.
Hello, Sheep, said Duck.
Bah, said Sheep.
But what she thought was,
he's going to hurt himself if he's not careful.
Duck was riding better now. He rode past Dog.
Hello, Dog,
said Duck.
Oof, said Dog.
But what he thought was,
that is a mighty neat trick.
Then Duck rode past Cat.
Hello, Cat,
said Duck.
Meow,
said Cat. But what she thought was, I wouldn't waste my time riding a bike. Duck pedaled a little faster. He rode past Horse.
horse, said Duck.
Neigh, said Horse. But what he thought was,
you're still not as fast as me, Duck.
Duck rang his bell as he rode toward Chicken.
Hello, Chicken,
said Duck.
Cluck, cluck,
said Chicken. But what she thought was,
watch where you're going, Duck!
Then Duck rode past Goat.
Hello, Goat,
said Duck.
Nah,
said Goat. But what he thought was,
I'd like to eat that bike.
Duck stood on the seat and rode past Pig and Pig.
Hello, pigs,
said Duck.
Oink,
said Pig and Pig. But what they thought was,
Duck is such a show-off.
Then Duck rode no hands past Mouse.
Hello, Mouse,
said Duck.
Squeak,
said Mouse. But what he thought was,
I wish I could ride a bike just like Duck.
Suddenly, a whole bunch of kids came down the road on bikes. They were in such a hurry that they didn't see Duck. They parked their bikes by the house and went inside. Now all the animals had bikes. They rode around and around the barnyard.
This is fun,
they all said.
Good idea, Duck.
Then they put the bikes back by the house. And no one knew that on that afternoon, there had been a cow, a sheep, a dog, a cat, a horse, a chicken, a goat, two pigs, a mouse, and a duck on a bike. The end?
Swimmy.
In a corner of the sea, there lived a happy school of little red fish. Only Swimmy was as black as a mussel shell, and he swam faster than his brothers and sisters. One bad day, a tuna, fierce and very hungry, was hunting for a juicy prey. Suddenly, he saw the little fish playing in the sunny water. There were no rocks, no weeds to hide in. And when they saw the glittering teeth, they darted here and there. It was too late. In a few hungry gulps, the tuna swallowed all of them. And then, with his belly full, he quietly swam away as if nothing had happened. But in the confusion, Swimmy had managed to escape. He swam away in the deep, wet world. He was scared, lonely, and very sad. Then things began to happen. A jellyfish full of the colors of the rainbow floated by. And behind a screen of weeds, an object full of prickles lay in the sand. Out came a crab with claws like the beaks of birds. "Catch me," said Swimmy. "Catch me. Catch me if you can." But a cuttlefish was pumping its way through the sea. And then it was night. Swimmy discovered a forest of seaweeds growing from sugar candy rocks. Large fish floated by, pulled by invisible threads. And out of tiny vases, large ocean flowers unfolded at the touch. And what was that? An eel, so long that his tail was almost too far away to remember. There were tunnels in the rocks. Luminous fish flickered in the dark. The world was full of wonders, and Swimmy was happy again. Then, in the deep shade of weeds, Swimmy saw a school of little fish. They were just like his brothers and sisters. "Let's go and play and see things," he said excitedly. "We can't," said the little fish. "The big fish will eat us all." "But you cannot live this way," said Swimmy. "We must think of something." Swimmy thought and thought. He thought of this, and he thought of that. And then he thought some more. Then suddenly he said, "I have it. We're going to swim together, each in his place." When they had taken the shape of one large fish, Swimmy said, "I'll be the eye." They swam into the open water where the tunas hunted. And they chased the big bad fish away.
After thinking it over for some time, Harold decided to go for a walk in the moonlight. There wasn't any moon, and Harold needed a moon for a walk in the moonlight, and he needed something to walk on. He made a long, straight path so he wouldn't get lost. And he set off on his walk, taking his big purple crayon with him. But he didn't seem to be getting anywhere on the long, straight path. So he left the path for a shortcut across a field. And the moon went with him. The shortcut led right to where Harold thought a forest ought to be. He didn't want to get lost in the woods. So he made a very small forest with just one tree in it It turned out to be an apple tree. The apples would be very tasty, Harold thought, when they got red. So he put a frightening dragon under the tree to guard the apples. It was a terribly frightening dragon. It even frightened Harold. He backed away. His hand, holding the purple crayon, shook. Suddenly, he realized what was happening. But by then, Harold was over his head in an ocean. He came up thinking fast. And in no time, he was climbing aboard a trim little boat. He quickly set sail. And the moon sailed along with him. After he had sailed long enough, Harold made land without much trouble. He stepped ashore on the beach, wondering where he was. The sandy beach reminded Harold of picnics, and the thought of picnics made him hungry. So he laid out a nice, simple picnic lunch. There was nothing but pie. But there were all 9 kinds of pie that Harold liked best. When Harold finished his picnic, there was quite a lot left over. He hated to see so much delicious pie go to waste. So, Harold left a hungry moose and a deserving porcupine to finish it up. And off he went, looking for a hill to climb to see where he was. Harold knew that the higher up he went, the farther he could see. So he decided to make the hill into a mountain. If he went high enough, he thought, he could see the window of his bedroom. He was tired, and he felt he ought to be getting to bed. He hoped he could see his bedroom window from the top of the mountain. But as he looked down over the other side, he slipped, and there wasn't any other side of the mountain. He was falling in thin air. But luckily, he kept his wits and his purple crayon. He made a balloon, and he grabbed onto it, and he made a basket under the balloon big enough to stand in. He had a fine view from the balloon, but he couldn't see his window. He couldn't even see a house. So he made a house with windows. And he landed the balloon on the grass in the front yard. None of the windows was his window. He tried to think where his window ought to be. He made some more windows. He made a big building full of windows. He made lots of buildings full of windows. He made a whole city full of windows. But none of the windows was his window. He couldn't think where it might be. He decided to ask a policeman. The policeman pointed the way Harold was going anyway, but Harold thanked him. And he walked along with the moon, wishing he was in his room and in bed. Then, suddenly, Harold remembered. He remembered where his bedroom window was when there was a moon. It was always right around the moon. And then Harold made his bed, got in it, and he drew up the covers.
the purple crayon dropped on the floor, and Harold dropped off to sleep.